Hello everyone and welcome. Today I want to begin talking about tiling problems. Tiling problems are a certain class of DP problem which involve counting the number of possible tilings on a board or a grid given tiles of various shapes and sizes. I love these types of problems because they're generally very intuitive and also lend themselves nicely to be transformed into straightforward recurrences. The problem we are going to have a look at today involves trying to figure out how many ways you can tile a board of length 5 with red tiles of length 1 and blue tiles of length 2. You can assume that there is an infinite amount of red and blue blocks at your disposal. As it turns out, for a board of length 5, there are exactly 8 possible tilings that you can make. A board filled with all red tiles, a board filled with one blue tile followed by 3 red tiles, a board with a red tile, a blue tile, and then 2 more red tiles, and so on. There are multiple ways of solving this problem, but today we are going to look at the top-down and the bottom-up approach, which use dynamic programming. We're going to begin with the top-down approach, where we assume that we have a full board we need to fill and break it down by placing red and blue tiles. In the end, we are going to know how many ways there are to tile the board by looking at how many full boards we have. I'm also going to define the function f of n to be the number of ways to tile a board of length n. You can see that on the left, we are trying to figure out what the value for f of 5 is. Since we only have two types of tiles, there are only two ways to break down a board of length 5, and that is by either placing a red block or by placing a blue block. When we place a red block, we create a separate branch to track that we now need to solve for the number of ways to tile a board of length 4, because the board is now one unit shorter. Similarly, we independently track a separate branch after we place a blue tile so that we can solve the problem for f of 3. We can continue breaking down our boards by again placing a red tile and a blue tile, where we left off in the previous state. I like visualizing placing tiles from the back of the board to show that the board is getting smaller. The goal we are ultimately trying to reach is having a board of length 0, because that's when we know that the board has been fully tiled with red and blue blocks. Once we reach the third iteration, you can see that some boards are already fully tiled, while some require more iterations still. The boards that are filled are those with a value of f of 0, which represents having exactly one way of tiling the board. You can also see at the bottom right that we have a value for f of negative 1. In that case, we overshot the board length and weren't able to place a tile on the board. I think what's important to focus on in this exercise is how much of the board remains to be tiled rather than how the boards were tiled specifically. We don't need to worry about the uniqueness of tilings because we know that all tilings will be unique from this breaking down process. Let's take a closer look at how we would handle the recursion to solve for the value of f of n, given that we now know how branching works. We start by trying to solve for the value of f of 5 because we want to know how many ways there are to tile a board of length 5. For every node, we're going to try and place a red block and a blue block. Placing a red block translates into solving for f of n minus 1, and placing a blue block translates into solving for f of n minus 2. We also know that once we reach f of 0, that we have finished tiling the board. Given all this, let's have a look at how the recursion would work. Recursion works depth first, so we begin on the left and explore the entire left branch of the tree first by considering all states which begin with a red block or end in a red block, whichever way you like to think about it. And this continues until we fill the board. Once we reach f of 0, we know that we have finished tiling the board in exactly one way, so we can stop and assign a value of 1 for this node. After that, the recursion pulls back. Once we're back at f of 1, we would try and place a blue block, but since the board only has a length of 1, at this stage we don't have enough room for a blue block, so we just sum up the value of all the children and return. Once we get to f of 2, now there's enough room to place a blue block. At f of 0, we know that we finished tiling a board, so we can return. As a side note, every time we are at a leaf node, like we are now, you can trace upwards along the tree back to the root node to know what sequence of blocks was used to tile the board. In this example, it was red, 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 blue. However, we know that there are 8 possible configurations, which means that our tree should have 8 leaves in total by the end of the recursion. Another way to think about the value contained in each node is that it tracks how many leaf nodes there are in the subtree below itself, because leaf nodes represent having finished tiling the board. At this point, I will let the animation play so you can observe how the recursion unfolds. Try and follow along. And that is the brute force method for how you would count the number of ways to tile a board of length 5 with tiles of size 1 and 2. The code to calculate f of n is actually very simple as well. The first line checks if we have a negative value of n. This can happen when we try and place too large of a block on the board without having enough space on the board. In this case, discard the state and return a count of 0. The second line checks if we have finished tiling the board by checking if n equals 0, and if so, return that we have found one valid tiling. And the final line sums together all the ways to place a red block and all the ways to place a blue block for the current board length. You may have noticed that the way we're calculating the number of tilings is pretty inefficient. In fact, the algorithm as is generates an exponential number of nodes because we divide each state into 2 nodes. However, lucky for us, there's a lot of overlap between numerous subtrees of the tree, which means we can store solutions to subproblems and reuse them whenever they pop up. The most obvious subtree with repetition is when we need to calculate f of 1. The value of f of 1 doesn't change depending on where it is in the tree. So if we calculate the value for f of 1 once, we can reuse it in these 5 places. Similarly for f of 2, but for a larger subtree. And yet again for f of 3. We can avoid recalculating the same subtree values if we cache already known subtree values in a memory table. Let's walk through the memoized version of how we would solve this problem and see if it's any faster. Notice that this time we have a memory cache at the bottom right side of this slide. This cache is just a map between the board length and the tile count. I'm going to let the animation play in the same manner as before until something interesting happens. So when we finish calculating the value for f of 0, we can store it in our table so that we can reuse it later. In practice, we don't actually need to store f of 0 just because f of 0 is our base case for the recursion, but it certainly doesn't hurt. So the recursion continues and we start unwinding the call stack. Similarly, we can also cache the value for f of 1 and store it in our table to save it for later occurrences. When we hit f of 0, we know that the value for this node is 1 because it's a leaf node and the base case for the recursion. On the callback for f of 2, we're able to store a value of 2 in the cache for later use. Things start to get interesting when we hit f of 1, because we can reuse the already known value for f of 1 from the cache without proceeding further down the tree. Then we can store the known value for f of 3 in the table. And once again, we can reuse the existing value in our cache to speed up the recursion and pull out the known value for f of 2. Then we can store the value for f of 4 on the callback. And once again, we can reuse the existing value for f of 3. And lastly, store the solution for f of 5, which is ultimately what we were after. So in the end, we get the same result, but we were able to drastically speed up the recursion by employing a state cache. Let's have a look at the implementation with caching. It's pretty similar to the recursive solution, except for one detail. The first thing I do is initialize a DP table of size n plus 1. This table will act as our map to make lookups easy. I often prefer using a static array as a cache instead of a map data structure because it's more lightweight and makes lookups and assignments easier. However, this is totally personal preference. As we step into the recursive function, you'll notice that our base cases remain unchanged because we're still trying to solve the same problem. However, immediately after we check the base case values, we check inside the cache to see if we've already calculated the value for f of n. And if we have, then great, we can return the stored value. Otherwise, calculate the value for f of n and store it in the DP table for next time. Then immediately return the value for f of n because that's what we were trying to calculate. In terms of time and space complexity, they're both linear in terms of n. The space complexity is linear because we use n memory for the cache, but also n memory for the recursion stack frames because our recursion can go as deep as n. The time complexity is also linear because with this caching mechanism, we have eliminated the exponential branching factor we had previously. Awesome. Now that we understand the top-down approach, I also want to quickly walk through the bottom-up approach, which is another way of thinking about how to solve the board tiling problem by starting with nothing and building the solution. So on the left side of the screen here, we have an empty set, which represents all the ways to tile a board of length 0. Then we ask ourselves, how many ways are there to tile a board of length 1? And the answer is, there is exactly one way to tile a board of length 1, and that is with a red block. After that, we continue and try to tile all boards of length 2, and we figure out that we can reuse a board of length 1, add a red tile to make a board of length 2, and also add a blue block to the empty board to also make a board of length 2. And similarly, to tile all boards of length 3. It's starting to become clear that we can reuse previous tilings and build upon them to generate the next set of tilings. I'll let the animation roll and see if you can figure out what's happening. So in the end, we were able to make one tiling of length 1, two tilings of length 2, three tilings of length 3, five tilings of length 4, and eight tilings of length 5. As we were building out the number of tilings, you may have noticed that the number of tilings in the next column was based off the previous two. This means that there's a recurrence relationship at play, in particular f of n. The number of tilings of length n can be calculated from the sum of f of n minus 1 and f of n minus 2. So we end up with the recurrence f of n equals f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2, which is the same as the recurrence from the top-down approach, but with perhaps a different interpretation when viewing the problem from a bottom-up approach. This recurrence represents the number of ways to make all tilings of length n using tiles of length 1 and 2. The left side of the equation, f of n minus 1, represents the number of tilings where we were able to append a red block to make a tiling of length n, At the right side of the equation, f of n minus 2 represents the number of tilings where we were able to append a blue block to make a tiling of length n. The pseudocode for the bottom-up approach is also fairly straightforward. Handle the cases for n equals 0 and n equals 1 at the beginning of the function. These two values act as the seed values for the recurrence, that's why I'm handling them separately. Then allocate memory for the DP table and initialize the first two values. After that, simply loop through the array and apply the recurrence relation building off known values in the DP table. Notice that the value of I starts at 2. That is because we already know the values for f of 0 and f of 1 in the array. And lastly, return the stored value at index n. If you liked this tiling problem, make sure to check out the project Euler problems 114 through to 117. These offer some interesting tiling challenges with different block sizes and more constraints. Awesome, guys. That's all I have on tiling problems for now. I hope you learned something new, and I'll catch you next time. Please remember to like this video and subscribe for more mathematics and computer science content. Thank you.